temporary one where the electronics sort of get upset and you reset them and they work again. But there can be damage that's permanent where you damage the circuits and you fry the board, essentially. And there's a very, very rigorous process of qualifying electronic parts for space. It's not the kind of stuff you just go to Radio Shack and buy stuff and put it together. These have gone through a very rigorous process of testing to make sure that they're not sensitive to that radiation. Optics, the lenses can be essentially get fogged up. So they start off clear, and if it's not the right kind of optics, if they're exposed to radiation, they get kind of fuzzy and blurry, like an old windscreen on your car, which gets all these scratches and things, and it just kind of messes up what you're trying to look at.
That's something we always worry about, because you get off-the-shelf cameras that work on the Earth, but when you take them to a different environment, it costs a whole lot of money to get things to Mars. So you want to make sure they're actually going to operate. Absolutely useful information. Becky, who's next?
The next one to ask, is there any redundancy built into the rover?
There is, I'm not an expert on the rover, but I do know there are a lot of redundant systems on there for good reason. Obviously, you don't want something to malfunction and then just be dead in the water. So there are multiple backup systems on a whole variety of key components that will allow it to continue to operate if something fails, and we'll have a backup.
I think most instruments we used to call them an A side and a B side, at least in the electronics, where if something goes bad, you can always switch to a different computer or circuit, but the spacecraft itself, that's throughout the system. You figure out what are the several things that could just kill you if this device fails, and then you always make sure you have a backup.
Yeah.
That's what really goes into the engineering and planning of the operation.
Steve, I think we have a question in the audience.
Okay.
Hi.
Well, you mentioned about certain atmosphere, about fluid spaceflight. What is the percentage of knowledge you need to go from, say, space station living for some long-term things to actually executing a flight to Mars, and how much will this mission fill in that gap?
So we need to repeat the question for our internet audience. So we have people in orbit around the Earth in the space station right now. And we know the radiation environment there. We're worried about sending people to Mars and what the radiation environment is going to do. How do you fill in the gap in our knowledge between those two very different destinations?
Right, well, there's obviously multiple aspects to sending humans from low Earth orbit all the way to Mars. The radiation environment is just one of those, and the radiation assessment detector will go a long way, basically, to at least knowing what the environment's going to be, because in fact, we don't know what it is. We've never measured it before. We certainly have measurements in interplanetary space, but we've never gone from Earth to Mars, and we've never measured it on the surface of Mars. So the first step in being able to put humans anywhere is to know what you're walking into. And that's what RAD can do, is tell us what that environment is. And then once we know, we can try to deal with it. There's a variety of other aspects, which I'm not an expert on, in terms of bone density and muscle loss and all those other psychological factors that go into a long journey to Mars, but I'm not qualified to talk about those. But people are looking at those.
I think that's, again, we build over time. They call it retiring the risk. We identify that radiation is a problem. How do you deal with that? We identify bone loss and weightlessness as a problem. What type of exercises do we do? And the space station answers a lot of that. There's still lots of things we don't know.
Thank you.